say my name. Over 1,000 young men have nominated. They've put up their hand for a crack at the big time. It's been a long journey to get even this far. Skills learned and mastered. Body and mind tried and tested. Scrutinised and analysed. For those who tick all the boxes, today they get drafted.
Pick number one.
That unforgettable moment when they hear their name called out and become AFL players.
Welcome to the AFL.
This year, they come here to the Gold Coast. The end of one football journey, the beginning of another. This is the 2012 NAB AFL Draft.
Good evening and welcome one and all to the 2012 NAB AFL Draft, coming to you live from the Gold Coast Convention Centre. Beautiful weather up here in the Sunshine State, but that is the last thing on our mind. We are talking about a critical evening for all 18 AFL clubs. They look to supplement their list with some of the best young talent in the country. Of course, it's not just about the top picks. We've got some father-son selections. We've got AFL players looking for second chances. Also some compensation picks and also some speculators. You might recall a number of years ago, a man by the name of James Hurd went at pick 79, so plenty of value deep in the draft. GWS have the first three picks of the draft, the Western Bulldogs, also two picks inside the top 10. Now, at any stage tonight, you can stay completely active in tonight's draft. Hit the red button and you'll see every single selection live. You don't have to listen to us. That's probably what I would be doing. Although when I think about the great talents sitting alongside me, maybe you do want to stick with us for a little while. A man who was an absolute legend with the Brisbane Lions. He's now a man running a very important company by the name of Velocity Sports. And one of their star pupils is Kurt Tippett, who's pretty much in the news of late. Alice Lynch, good evening to you, Lynchy.
Good evening, Jace. Yeah, looking forward to tonight. Should be a great night.
I need to hit you right between the eyes off the top, mate. Tomorrow week, I think we're expecting the decision from the AFL. What's your gut feel about how it's going to play out?
Well, I suppose it's not for me to speculate on how the Commission will rule on that, but certainly it's a significant charge, and obviously that's been reinforced by the actions of the Adelaide Crows in the last 24 hours. So Kurt and his manager are both looking forward to presenting to the Commission next Friday.
All right, we wait with bated breath for that. Alongside him, the assistant coach of the AFL AIS Academy. He was also a superstar with the Western Bulldogs, their games record holder, Brad Johnson. Good evening to you, Jono.
Good evening, Jase.
You've worked with a lot of the young kids that are looking to get drafted tonight.
Yeah, I was lucky enough to work with 30 of the best this year. And when you look at the draft, it's going to be a fantastic draft overall. I think it's going to go very deep. And what you'll find is clubs will recruit a lot of players tonight that will have an impact in season 2013.
All right, and let's face it, no draft is complete without the AFL National and International Talent Manager, the man, Kevin Sheehan, who affectionately goes by the nickname Shifter, is with us once again. Shifter, great to see you, mate.
Terrific to be here, Jase.
And what are we expecting?
Well, I think that the clubs have been thorough. They've tested more than 220 players with draft combines around the nation. They've now got to make a decision on which way they'll go. They'll pick those with a skill set and that competitive edge that can really help their list. I'm predicting there'll be 75 players, new talent if you like, getting their chance in the AFL at the end of tonight.
All right, a lot to look forward to. The big story over the past month has certainly been the Adelaide Crows, and in the last 24 hours they've decided to relinquish their top two picks. So picks 20 and 54 have disappeared. They now come in at pick 62, and they'll also have 81 and 95 perhaps, preempting a little bit of the punishment that's coming from the AFL and trying to soften the blow first up.
Well, you mentioned James Hurd at 79. Chris Grant went at 105 way back when. So that's what Adelaide will be looking for. They'll be looking to pinch one there late. And their list at the moment is very strong. So to give up the first two this year won't impact them immediately. Maybe in the future it will, but immediately they're very strong. Got a very strong list.
And there's only two live picks there. Obviously, Ian Callanan at pick 95 will be elevated off the rookie list. So he's been a fantastic player over the last couple of years that will get his chance on the main list.
He has been. If you're not sure who's got the top 10 picks tonight, let's just recap those. As I mentioned, GWS have picks 1, 2 and 3. Melbourne come in at 4. The Bulldogs with picks 5 and 6. Then it's Port Adelaide, the Brisbane Lions, Richmond and Essendon rounding out the top 10. I'm sure you're sitting at home wondering who your club's going to pick up. Well, these are the selections that they do have tonight. Every club has to take a minimum of three selections, but some will certainly be going deeper than that.
And you look at the Collingwood Footy Club, they've got some great picks there.
They've done well.
18, 19 and 20, and you might wonder how do they get that, but obviously they've traded away. There's a compensation pick for Sharad Wellingham going to the West Coast Eagles, and there's one pick 21 now, that is 20 for Chris Dawes as well. So they've done very well, and that should be significant at that stage of the draft.
And you can't discount what GWS were able to do to get the first three selections as well, going and giving away the, through the mini draft with their selection, so therefore they get 1, 2 and 3.
All right, let's go on stage now to Anthony Hudson. He's going to officially get the 2012 NAB AFL draft underway.
Well, thank you, Jason, and good evening, everyone. Well, what a huge night it is, particularly for the more than 1,600 young players who have nominated for tonight's NAB AFL draft, from as far north as the Tiwi Islands to the most southerly tips of Tasmania. And to all those nervous young men and their families who are either in the room with us here on the Gold Coast or watching the coverage right around the country on Fox Footy, we wish you all the best. The top 10 players from 2011 all played senior football this year, with Chad Wingard from Port Adelaide the most games with 19. In a moment, we count this year's top 10 from 1 to 10. GWS will have the first three selections, while the reigning premiers, the Sydney Swans, first pick is at selection 22, and the runners-up Hawthorn is at selection 28. So let's get the 2012 NAB AFL draft underway, and we welcome the CEO of the AFL, Andrew Demetriou.
Thank you, Anthony. Good evening and welcome to the 27th NAB AFL draft selection meeting, being held here again at the Gold Coast Convention and Exhibition Centre. Thank you to all AFL club representatives, representatives from the AFL Players Association, aspiring young AFL players and their parents, accredited agents and members of the media. As this is the first time that all of our clubs have been together since the end of the 2012 Premiership season, I think it's only appropriate that we congratulate John Longmire and the Sydney Swans on their win in a wonderful grand final. Congratulations. I want to acknowledge representatives of the National Australia Bank, our partners in the NAB AFL Rising Stars program, which provides recognition, resources and support to local football communities. In particular, representing NAB here tonight, I wish to welcome Tim Clark, Head of Enterprise Sponsorship and Events, and Ross Blunton, who is the Business Banking Executive. I also want to make a special thanks to the Queensland Government and Events Queensland for their wonderful support. It is really fantastic to be here on the Gold Coast. Providing live television coverage for tonight's draft is the Fox Footy Channel, radio stations 3AW, 5AA, SEN, 1116, Gold FM, and will also be broadcasting throughout the evening. The AFL website, afl.com.au, is providing live streaming coverage. And for all other members of the media tonight, thank you again for your coverage of the NAB AFL Draft. Would now like to introduce the people sitting at the table on my left. Adrian Anderson, AFL General Manager, Football Operations. Andrew Dillon, AFL General Manager, Legal and Business Affairs. And Rod Austin, Football Administration Manager. All AFL clubs are entitled to have up to 8 persons in attendance to represent them at this meeting. 2 club representatives are permitted to sit at the club draft selection table and select players. I will call out the draft selection number and the name of the club in the order noted in the NAB AFL draft selection schedule that has been circulated to clubs previously. The ID number, the player's name and previous club must be called out clearly. In the case of a player drafted for the first time, I would also ask you to call out their junior club as indicated on the nomination list circulated. The players selected in the top 10 will make their way to the stage and they will be presented with their club jumper. After the number 10 pick is announced, all of our top 10 will briefly be presented on the main stage. The remainder of the selections from selection 11 to 24 will then be made before we take a 4-minute break. Each club will be permitted 2 minutes to make their selection. If necessary, you are requested to indicate that additional time is required and a further 2-minute extension will be granted. Finally, can I please remind all people here tonight to make sure you have your mobile phones switched off. I would now like to hand over to Adrian Anderson, AFL's General Manager of Football Operations.
Thank you, Andrew. All clubs have been advised of the exchanges of players that have affected the normal order of choice of players by clubs, and the revised draft order was issued to all clubs yesterday. This year, 28 players have been pre-listed by clubs, comprising 24 that have been promoted from the rookie list, 3 players that have been selected under the father-son rule, and 1 player as a priority zone selection by the Gold Coast Suns. 49 players have agreed to be retained by their club as a second or third year rookie. None of these players can be selected by another club at this draft meeting. The names of all these players have been circulated. All clubs must make a minimum of 3 selections at this draft, which can include the pre-listed players I mentioned earlier. A club is not required to use a pick gained from a trade during the AFL exchange period. Once a club passes on a selection, it is excluded from further involvement in this draft meeting, other than for the naming of pre-listed players. Finally, I would like to take the opportunity to acknowledge the excellent work of outgoing Football Administration Manager Rod Austin in administering this year's draft, as he has done so expertly for many drafts gone by.
Thank you, Adrian. Well, the waiting is over. It is time for the 2012 NAB AFL Draft. And once again, Andrew Demetriou.
Thanks, Anthony. Round 1, selection 1, GWS Giants.
Player number 213189, Lockie Whitfield, Dandenong Stingrays, Mount Martha Junior Football Club.
Classy running machine with laser-like delivery with either foot, Lockie Whitfield this year followed in the footsteps of Paul Salmon, Mark Murphy and Tom Hawkins to win the Lark Medal for the best player at the NAB AFL Under 18 Championships, where he averaged 23 disposals.
Lockie has some traits like Scott Pendlebury, smooth mover, great skills, elite endurance and a fantastic work ethic.
Whitfield on the left foot and he kicks it straight through.
Whitfield is regarded by recruiters as a special talent.
The 2012 NAB AFL Draft number 1 selection, Lockie Whitfield to the GWS Giants. Well, Kevin, you were in this position last year, you got some wonderful talent, had a terrific first year, and what's made Lockie be your number 1 choice tonight?
Oh, look, he's just a great player, the way he actually plays through his matches. And, of course, he's got some good speed. He's obviously a very good kick. We try to make sure we pick pretty good kicks, obviously, with decision-making as well. And a bit of height, which is good. I like that running height. I think that, I think Hawthorne shown a way that they've got some good running height in their team. And I think that we need to bring that to the Giants.
Well, you've got another couple of picks to come. Congratulations, Lockie. How does it feel to be that number 1 pick? I mean, you've got footy in your family. It's a wonderful honour.
Yeah, it's very humbling, something that I hold very deep within me. I'm very honoured to, be the number 1 selection, and I guess all the hard work over the past few years has paid off.
And you know a few of the boys, don't you? You're going to become your teammates from your AIS days?
Yeah, well, last year I played with the likes of Devon Smith and Taylor Adams from Big Country, and then, Matthew Bunting and Nick Haynes from Dandenong Stingrays as well, a lot of boys through the AIS as well. So, yeah, it'd be pretty good to get up there and see them again.
What are you looking like that for, Sheeds?
Well, they just said make sure you get him, that's all. So that's a message from the team. They love him as a player. They wanted to get him to the club. And I think that sort of camaraderie and morale where you've got young people really enjoying wanting to be in near each other is going to just be fantastic for the Giants.
Well, it is fantastic for the Giants. Exciting for you, Lockie. You've got Sheeds for this year. That's something to look forward to. Also to look forward to, I'd like to call on Ross Blunton from the NAB to present. Here he is. How are you, Ross? To present a $10,000 portfolio, which will certainly help Lockie on his way. So much appreciated for that for NAB. A round, final round of applause for Lockie Whitfield, and we wish him all the best. And we'll go back to you, Andrew, for selection two.
Selection two, GWS Giants.
Player number 213767, Jonathan O'Rourke, Calder Cannons, Gisborne Rookies.
O'Rourke still working, deserves a goal, and he's got it.
Hailing from the Calder Cannons, Jonathan O'Rourke is a medium-sized midfielder who gathers possessions at will and uses the ball extremely well.
Again, it's O'Rourke. He's having an outstanding first quarter.
Jonathan is a prolific ball winner who's so clean below his knees and also a beautiful, classy distributor of the football, very much in the mould of Trent Cotchin.
A good decision maker in heavy traffic, O'Rourke can run all day and in the under-18 championships attained the elite disposal efficiency rate of 77%.
Been impressed by what I've seen of Jonathan O'Rourke.
The number two selection, Jonathan O'Rourke from the GWS Giants.
Selection three, GWS Giants.
Player number 213327, Lockie Plowman, Calder Cannons, Macedon Football Club.
Lockie Plowman is a 192 centimetre attacking defender with a great ability to win the contested ball both in the air and on the ground. He has poise with the ball in his hands, makes clever decisions, and was in great form with the Australian under-18 team and the Calder Cannons before injury ruled him out of the under-18s championships.
Lachlan's the best tall defender in the draft, very much like Andrew Mackey, has an amazing ability to read the ball in the air and is a brutal competitor.
Plowman finished off the season strongly when he returned for the Cannons, and he has the ability to make his mark at the elite level.
The number three draft selection, Lockie Plowman to the GWS Giants. Well done, congratulations Lockie, and we wish the Giants all the best with their first three selections. Now pick four.
Selection four, Melbourne.
Player number 213114, Jimmy Tumpus. Woodville West Torrens, Flinders Park Football Club.
Energetic South Australian captain Jimmy Tumpus boasts an outstanding work ethic and a big engine in the midfield.
Tumpus has got speed to run away from the contest.
He is a terrific ball winner who prides himself on his kicking efficiency.
Watch this hit the target. Spot on.
Jimmy is a great decision maker by foot, a great leader on and off the field, a potential AFL captain in the making.
Tumpus? Yeah, look at that. That's just one of them.
He was one of Woodville West Torrens' best players in their 2011 SANFL Premiership win, playing as a 17-year-old, and this year won all Australian under-18 honours by averaging more than 22 disposals.
Yes, he's pick four. Jimmy Tumpus is off to the Demons.
Selection five, Western Bulldogs.
Player number 213275, Jake Stringer, Bendigo Pioneers, Eagle Hawk Football Club.
Jake Stringer is one of the feel-good stories at this year's draft.
Stringer, he's a man possessed at the moment, Stringer.
Last year was a write-off for the rugged Bendigo Pioneer Vic Country Tall, who badly broke his leg in the Pioneers' first match of the year. Since then, he has completed a painful yet successful rehabilitation, and some strong performances in the VFL toward the end of this season have reignited the interest of AFL recruiters.
At selection five, Jake Stringer is now a Western Bulldog.
Selection six, Western Bulldogs.
Player number 213647, Jack McRae, Oakley Chargers, Q Rovers Football Club.
It's been an amazing past 12 months for Jackson McRae.
Lovely kick in from Jackson McRae.
Year ago, he couldn't get a game for the Oakley Chargers, and this year, his wobbly golden point gave the Chargers an overtime win in the TAC Cup Grand Final.
Jackson, to me, is a player who loves to change the game. The angles the game's played at, he loves to run and carry, his bulk's amazing, but the main feature of his play is his voice. You can hear him from 100 metres away, demanding the football.
Another likely type, Jackson McRae.
Off-field, as quiet as a mouse, on-field, a different man.
Jackson McRae, he is pick six, and he's headed to the Western Bulldogs under Brendan McCartney.
Selection seven, Port Adelaide.
Player number 213650, Oliver Wines, Bendigo Pioneers, the Chuka Junior Football Club.
At 90 kilograms, Oliver Wines is a strongly built midfielder with a hard edge. He is a stoppage specialist who thrives on winning the contested ball, and he loves nothing better than making bone-crunching tackles.
There's the tackle from Wines.
Ollie is an in-and-under type, competitive beast. He's a great decision-maker.
A good overhead mark for his size, Wines has elite endurance, which often sees him pushing forward to hit the scoreboard.
Gee, that's a good finish from Wines. Nothing wrong with that kick.
Oliver Wines, he joins Port Adelaide under new coach Ken Hinckley. At selection seven.
Selection eight, Brisbane Lions.
Player 213197, Sam Mays, North Adelaide Football Club, Port Junior Football Club.
Sam Mays hails from the South Australian city of Port Pirie.
Looking for Mays, got him, good mark.
Possessing good speed, elite agility and an X factor, Mays was rewarded with a second All-Australian selection for his performances in the Under-18 Championships.
Sam is a lead-up forward, good hands, excellent foot skills and can be dangerous and brilliant around goals.
Brisbane's new player is selection eight, Sam Mays. The Lions represented tonight by Mark Harvey.
Selection nine, Richmond.
Player number 213659, Nick Flostone, Northern Knights Eltham Junior Football Club.
As captain of Vic Metro's championship-winning team, Nick Flostone is regarded as one of the most fearless players in this year's draft.
And his attack on the ball is ferocious.
Exceptionally strong at clearances, the Northern Knights' hard-nut plays with the same ferocity as Hawk Brad Sewell and is more than willing to push back into defence to help his backman.
He's very good in traffic, isn't he?
His performances in this year's NAB AFL Under-18 Championships were awarded with All-Australian honours.
Beautiful kick that. That's outstanding pass.
Nick Flostone is the number nine selection in the 2012 NAB AFL Draft. And he's off to the Tigers under Damien Hardwick.
Selection 10, Essendon.
Player 213870, Joe Danaher, Calder Cannons and Aberfeldy Football Club.
Looking for Danaher, why wouldn't you? Why wouldn't you?
Taken by the Bombers as a father-son selection, Joe Danaher keeps alive one of the most famous surnames at Windy Hill.
Here was history in the making, yeah. The four Danahers running out together.
Father Anthony and uncles Terry, Neil and Chris all wore the black and red with distinction, and young Joe looks equipped to continue the family dynasty.
Big Joe.
Yes.
Look at that.
A tall forward with excellent hands, Danaher evokes memories of a young Paul Salmon.
Joe is a rare talent, a key forward ruckman who can dominate the air and also be as good at ground level.
Big Joe, he is, and he punches the air.
Joe is one of the most exciting key forwards to come into the game for a long time.
He's the number 10 selection, father-son of course, Joe Danaher. Well, congratulations, Joe. You've known for a while this was going to happen, but finally it's here.
Yeah, finally it's a really big relief for me just to, you know, finally be here and, you know, holding an Essendon jumper. It's a really big honour for me.
And it's a proud heritage that your family has already at the club. That must be exciting. Does it put any extra pressure on you?
Yeah, absolutely. It's exciting. But, for me it doesn't weigh any more pressure than anyone else here. And, you know, it's an exciting night for a lot of people and, the lives of these guys will change with the opportunity in AFL Football Club just like it will for me.
Well, good luck. It's an exciting night for you and for everyone. You've certainly got the height for it. Good luck at the Bombers.
Thanks, Anthony.
Let's call on his father, Anthony. That's a little more comfortable for me. Mate, it's obviously huge. The family have done so much for the club already and the club's given the family so much, but it must be so exciting.
It was great, Hutto. He gets, for all these young boys, they get a chance to live their dream, and Joe gets that chance now, and we're thrilled. The family's thrilled, and he's at Essendon where there's been a great legacy, and he gets a chance to carry that on.
The four brothers played together back in 1990, so it's great to see that can continue.
Let's hope he can add to the numbers.
Yeah. Now, has he got his old man covered, or do you reckon what areas were you better than him?
Oh, no, very few. He's a different kid. He's got a very real steely attitude to play the game. He's worked really hard from a little tacker, and he's really mastered his game, and I think he's way ahead of us old dinosaurs who played a long time ago.
Well, congratulations to the family, and we wish him all the best in you as well.
Thanks, Hutto.
Cheers. That's the top 10. We're going to call on them now again for one last look at the top 10 selections for the 2012 NAB AFL Draft, starting with number 1, Lachie Whitfield from the GWS Giants, Jonathan O'Rourke, and Lachie Plowman also with GWS, Jimmy Tumpus at number 4, who's now a Demon, Jake Stringer and Jackson McRae, who joined the Western Bulldogs, Oliver Wines in the Port Adelaide jumper for the first time, Sam Mays, who becomes a Brisbane Lion at 8, Nick Floston, who joins Richmond at 9, and Joe Danaher, who is now a Bomber. They are your top 10, ladies and gentlemen. Let's wish them all the best.
So there are your top 10 picks of 2012. GWS, of course, with picks 1, 2 and 3. What a list they are building. Shift, I don't think we saw too many surprises there in the top 10.
But we had one. Jake Stringer was a surprise, not in all the phantom drafts, and I can see why the Bulldogs picked him. He's a great one-on-one player with a hard edge, a great contested mark. He kicked 8 goals in his first game back from a broken leg, so he's a wonderful story.
All right, let's head back now to Andrew Dimitriou for the rest of round 1.
Selection 11, Carlton.
Player 213653, Troy Menzel, Central Districts, Golden Grove.
Selection 12, GWS Giants.
Player number 213786, Christian Jacks, Oakley Chargers, Q Rovers.
Selection 13, Gold Coast Suns.
Player number 213550, Jesse Lonergan, Launceston Football Club and Launceston Junior Football Club.
Selection 14, GWS Giants.
Player number 213655, Aidan Corr, Northern Knights, McLeod Football Club.
Selection 15, North Melbourne.
Player 213250, Taylor Garner, Dandenong Stingrays, Roeville.
Selection 16, Geelong Cats.
Player 213310, Jackson Thurlow from Launceston and Launceston Junior Footy Club.
Selection 17, Fremantle.
Player number 213706, Joshua Simpson, East Fremantle, Mullawa Football Club.
Selection 18, Collingwood.
Player 213661, Brody Grundy, Sturt, Unley Jets.
Selection 19, Collingwood.
Player 213119, Ben Kennedy, Glenelg, Brighton District.
Selection 20, Collingwood.
Player 213209, Tim Broomhead, Port Adelaide Magpies, Port District.
Selection 21, Western Bulldogs.
Player number 213337, Nathan Rovat, Northern Knights, Mill Park Football Club.
Selection 22, Sydney Swans.
Double 3-5, Dean Towers, North Ballarat and Otway Districts Football Clubs.
After round one compensation pick, selection 23, Brisbane Lions.
Player 213086, Marco Paparone, East Fremantle, Palmyra Junior Football Club.
So that completes round one in the 2012 NAB AFL Draft. We saw the top 10 earlier. We're going to recap picks 11 through 23. It's been an outstanding start in terms of the amount of talent that we've seen, gents, and it's starting to shape up as some good lists being built, aren't they?
Absolutely, and there's some names that I didn't recognise. Did you see anything that really jumped out at you?
I think the big winners in that are Collingwood. They've got Brody Grundy, the back-to-back All-Australian Ruckman, and Ben Kennedy, the back-to-back All-Australian Rover. Both played together, had a wonderful relationship in the way they worked off each other, so I think that they're great picks. Lucky enough to get them in a row there. So to have players of that quality, they're only top tens.
That is a talking point, the Ruckman going so late in the draft. Well, you would have thought Brody could have gone anywhere between 6 and 20.
Well, I think 6 of the 27 drafts will send the Ruckman taken at number one, back to the Matthew Cruisers, way back to Jeff White, etc., Josh Fraser. But there's a big swing to the midfielders now. I think 9 now of the number ones have been medium midfielders.
Well, the thing about the midfielders is they're more often ready-made players, aren't they? And there's a long-term investment if you take Ruckman particularly early, and sometimes I think clubs like to see a little bit of reward prior to 4 or 5 years down the track.
And you do see with the development of the kids that it's midfield, but there's also a defensive element, or they can push forward and get on the scoreboard as well.
All right, we'll take a break before we get into round two. Looking forward to Hawthorn's first pick coming up at number 28. We'll also catch up with this year's number one draft in just a moment. Welcome back to the 2012 NAB AFL Draft. Don't forget you can stay active right throughout the draft. Simply hit the red button. You'll see every draft selection live. But right now, well, the first round is done. It is time to get into round two. Let's go back to Andrew Demetriou.
Round 2, selection 24, St Kilda.
Player ID 213217, Nathan Wright, Dandenong Stingrays, Berwick Junior Football Club.
Selection 25, St Kilda.
Player ID 213152, Spencer White, Western Jets, Spotswood Junior Football Club.
Selection 26, Melbourne.
Player ID 213871, Jack Viney, Casey Scorpions, Ashburton Junior Football Club.
Selection 27, GWS Giants.
Player number 213388, James Stewart, Sandringham Dragons, Glen Iris Junior Football Club.
Selection 28, Hawthorne.
Player 213069, Tim O'Brien, Glenelg, West Gambia Junior Football Club.
Selection 29, Port Adelaide.
All right, so don't forget to hit the red button if you want to stay active and watch every single pick live. But right now we've got the pleasure of talking to the number one draft pick in the country, Lockie Whitfield. Lockie, welcome to you and congratulations. How are you feeling?
I don't really know at the moment. It's pretty unreal. Like, it's all gone so fast, and seeing all the boys go top 10 and just, you know, being able to get around each other out the back room is it's a pretty great feeling.
You're looking very comfortable in the GWS jumper very early. When did you know you were going to go number one?
Well, it kind of got tagged along with my name for the majority of the year, but not till just recently was I told that I could go at possibly in the top three, but tonight was the real deal.
Shifter along at the end there, he's bracketed you in a group that is very, very elite. He's one of the best players of the past decade. How do you go hearing that sort of stuff? For a man that's seen every draft that's been in the AFL.
And we're saying, Lockie, about your kicking, the elite kicking, the elite running, that's what separates you. Where does the kicking come from?
Well, just with the deficiency of my weight not being as big as the other boys, I knew that I had to try and get another asset to my game that I could be at a higher level at. So I've just focused on my kicking ever since I was young on both sides. A lot of practice and a lot of hours just kicking to myself.
Lockie wins young. When did you really get into the kicking?
As soon as I got a footy in my hands, I was trying to kick on both feet ever since under 10s. And I remember once I had a set shot on my left foot and Dad cracked it at me a bit. But, at least I was trying.
Don't worry, the left foot's only for balance, Lockie. You don't need to worry about that too much with your speed and endurance. But you speak of strength. You spent a week with St Kilda. How was that? And were there any elements of training where you think that's the main element that I need to improve on?
Yeah, well, I'm doing just the different types of weights that the Saints did with me. It's really a good eye-opener to what a pre-season's like. I'd really never done leg weights before, and I could barely walk the next day. So, I know that the coming summer at the Giants, the weights will probably hit me the hardest, but I'm really looking forward to it.
As you said when you were up chatting to Hutto before, you know a number of the players at GWS already, and Bunting and Haynes are certainly ones. Trelaw and Scully are Danny Stingray's boys as well. Do you see that there's a position there in round one? Are you confident you can grab a spot for the start of the season?
Yeah, there's a lot of great players already there, and they've had a really good season and played probably above everyone else's expectations for the year. But I'll train my hardest over pre-season and try and get my name up for selection. But
straight in the middle?
I wish. As I said, there's a lot of great midfielders already there, and I'll have to earn the respect of them first and then the selection committee.
I think one thing we know about Kevin Sheedy is he doesn't mind giving the youngsters an opportunity straight up either. I've got to ask you, Lockie, I know players are prepared to go anywhere these days. It is a national competition. Where did your loyalties lie as you were growing up?
This is a loaded question. That's a disgrace.
Oh, mate, I'm just showing some interest.
Back for the Hawks all the way through. But my loyalty this year kind of faded away as I saw my mates playing for the Giants and just wanting them to play good footy.
Don't tell me your favourite player was Jason Dunstall.
You weren't born Jason. That's one consolation.
I will ask you about your family. It's a big step for the family too, because you're about to head interstate. So they've had you around and probably go to most of the games. How have they handled the fact that you're heading interstate?
Yeah, well, we've had the majority of the year to talk about it and discuss it. And I think we're really looking forward to the opportunity as a whole family. Like, I'll have to, learn to be independent and cook and clean for myself. But, it's something that, we've got our heads around and really looking forward to.
And Lockie, just the athletic genes, where do they come from? Because you are an elite, a very elite runner. Is that the mum's side, the dad's side? Who's claiming sort of that ability?
I don't really know, because dad obviously wasn't much of a runner. He just started full forward. And
hey, don't underrate full forward.
There's a few here. On my mum's side, my pa was a sprinter. But I'm not really too sure where the long distance gene's from. Mum will kill me for saying it, but she did a little bit of longest distance
so
stuff.
It's the mum.
She did very little. But I just took a liking to it as a junior and did a lot of cross country and athletics, and I guess it's helped my game.
Outside of the game, what are your interests outside of the game? Are you going to study, things like that, just to keep motivation there for when you do turn up to training?
Yeah, well, being at St Kilda for the week in summer really opened my eyes to telling me that, you know, I probably won't be able to do uni this next year, because, you know, the workload's so big and, you know, you're going to bed at 7:30. But the following year, I'll definitely look into something like exercise and sports science.
Yeah, well, the sports science seems to work pretty well, or is it just natural that you've had three MVPs with Vic Country? So you haven't missed too many games. Obviously, the injuries are okay.
Yeah, well, I've never really had a serious injury. Maybe just my ankles roll over every now and then. But, I just guess I've been pretty lucky so far.
All right, well, we were talking about the impact it has on the family. Our inside man is Ben Dixon, who's roving the floor and doing the interviews for us, and he's caught up with a very interested mother in Marianne Whitfield.
Thanks, Jason. Marianne, it's finally official. It's been a big year for Lockie and the family. You're touted the number one, but you must be absolutely thrilled.
Yes, it was wonderful, that moment, him being called out. It was the best feeling, better than I expected.
And he had a terrific year this year, and no doubt he earned the number one spot. But it's a lot of pressure for a young boy, isn't it?
Yeah, he had a hard year. AIS, Vic Country, school footy, Stingrays. It's pretty hard when you split over all those things. So he stands up pretty well, the old lock.
And his father, Richard, played for Hawthorn in the under-19s. But they tell me the running ability, the speed comes from your side. Is there any truth to that?
My dad can run. However, it's falsely reported that I was an elite runner. I was not an elite runner. I just ran for fun.
How's he going to cope up in Sydney now with the cooking? Is he any good at home?
Bacon and eggs. No, he's not very good. I've tried and I'm disappointed, but no, he can't cook. So I've taught him basic steamed vegetables and meat, but no, I think he'll get looked up after there, up there. Craig Lambert and his wife seem to do a pretty good job from what I hear. So I'm pretty confident.
And the whole family's Hawthorn now. Are you going to relinquish the membership and GWS it is?
That's going to be difficult, especially for my daughter and, well, for my husband. I think Lockie will adapt. My nephew was drafted to Hawthorn last year, so the family's, you know, pretty happy about that. So, we'll barrack for GWS home and away, and then Hawthorn grand final time. However, GWS would probably be in the finals pretty soon, hopefully.
Well, no doubt about that. And GWS, obviously new to the competition, it's exciting. But the group of young players, obviously, is just going to embrace Lockie.
It's got a lot of friends up there. We've got to know a lot of people through the AIS and Vic Country. So a lot of the boys keep in touch with him. They've pranked him recently. he's keen. He's really keen to go there. And we have a family member who's slightly involved up there. He lives up there, so he's got someone to rely on.
Appreciate your time, Marianne. Thanks very much, and congratulations.
Thank you. Thanks a lot.
Great work, Dicko. Well, mums don't lie, Lockie. She's disappointed. You haven't caught on to the cooking lessons yet.
No, not quite. I'll have to try and prove
it.
Get around
and see Melissa Lambert. She'll look after. There's no doubt about that. They're a very good family that look after a lot of the young boys at GWS.
So just talking about the arrangements, when will you head up now, and how does it all pan out?
We'll head up Sunday, Sunday afternoon, and I guess, you know, I'll get up there, we'll live with another player and a development coach, and get stuck into pre-season.
Do you know who those people that you'll be living with are as yet? Because sometimes it's a lot easier if you live with someone that you've got a bit of chemistry with, someone that you kind of get along well with.
Yeah, well, all the boys that have been selected just now are all Victorians, and we've all previously been in the AIS together, so yeah, there's a lot of chemistry, I guess, between us, and already know each other really well, so whoever I end up living with, I'm sure I'll be fine.
And a number of the boys are starting to move out of Breakfast Point, from what I hear.
Yep. I think it's just all very footy-focused in there, so they're just trying to get a release. But from all reports, they're only just moving out 100, 200 metres down the road.
Oh, right, so it's not too far.
What number do you want to wear? Or have you been given a number yet?
No, I haven't. I don't really know what's free, but I usually wear 7, but I think Reece Palmer's got that. I doubt I'll get it. A
couple of years, it might be yours then.
Shifter, when are we expecting to see this young man in action next season?
Oh, he'll play. There's no doubt he'll play with his skill set. It's a matter of building up physically. He'll certainly dominate through the running over the summer. And just for his use of the football, I'm sure Kevin Sheedy will find a spot pretty early.
Is there any of your Dandenong Stingrays teammates that haven't been called out yet that you're expecting to be nominated?
Well, there was four boys that we thought that were pretty much certainties, and I think three of them have been picked. I'm not too sure. I'm not really keeping up with it.
You missed the last couple, yeah, obviously.
I don't know if Jason Pongrassic's been yet, but if he hasn't, I'm pretty sure he'll get picked up.
Yep.
And the Saints are taking their time here. That's why there's a little bit of that. You can take up to 4 minutes, you get two, and you get the extension of two. So St Kilda at choice 43 taking their time. Now, one recycled player, North Melbourne, pick up Ben Jacobs from Port Adelaide. Ben, who's had a couple of years over there, looks a real good promising player, but just wanted to come back to Victoria. So they waited patiently, and they've got him at choice 37. And another guy that you would have seen play in James Stewart from the Sandringham Dragons. Now, he was available father-son to Collingwood. They overlooked that. He's gone at choice 27. He'll become a teammate of yours, and you've actually come to the academy with Big Stewie.
Yeah, obviously, as I said before, the boys that have been drafted up have been part of the AIS. And yeah, I got to know Stewie really well over the trip, and he's a really great guy and great asset for the Giants now.
So, Shifter, if St Kilda have asked for an extension of time, that means probably maybe a couple of players have snuck through and that they weren't expecting to be there. So instead of just thinking, well, we'll take this bloke here, hang on, a couple more have become available, and it's a real powwow there, isn't it? The power broker's just working out who they want to take.
Yeah, and they've taken the earlier choices. Nathan Wright, a teammate of Lockie's, a half-back, a very powerful player from the Dandenong Stingrays, and Spencer White, a tall forward. So maybe it's about balance. You know, they might be thinking, do we go pure midfield now? Because
well, we can see Chris Pelkin certainly leading a lot of the conversation there. He's in charge of all the player strategy at St Kilda. And you're right, sometimes it's not just the best player per se. It's what positions you're trying to fill, isn't it?
And Tony Elshaw, the recruiting manager, former premiership player with the Bombers, of course, he'll be the one that's about to make the call.
And we do know that at times the high draft picks need to go to a different environment to just get another chance. And I think, for memory, Ben Jacobs was approximately pick 16, certainly a first rounder.
He was.
We know Jordan Gisberts has gone from Melbourne to North Melbourne. So sometimes as that pick comes out of Josh Saunders from Geelong Falcons, he'll go to St Kilda. Sometimes a different environment can work.
Flying machine, the gone midfield, he's a dasher, absolute goal of the year, I'd say, at TAC Cup level. I saw in the final, this bloke's bounced it four times and kicked it, and if you sometimes have a blink moment, you say, well, that's the moment that guy got himself drafted. That was the moment for Josh.
It's interesting that we see so many midfielders continually get drafted, but you can only have so many midfielders in each team, so some of them need to be adaptable, and you might even get opportunities to play half forward, half back, Lockie. Is that something you can get your head around?
Well, yeah, as you said, a lot of midfielders are picked, for, I guess, for that versatility reason. But, yeah, I played a lot forward this year through the Vic Country and even school football. So I guess I probably could play that role. I'd like to try and try down back as well, but, you know, I'm
guessing. You don't want to get cemented in down there.
No, maybe on the back flank.
Where's the favourite position?
So in the guts.
You get in the middle.
All right, round two is complete, and we're certainly going to keep you up to speed with everything that's happened throughout the course of the evening. These are round two picks, kicked off with selection 24 and 25 for the Saints. The Hawks coming in at 28 with Tim O'Brien. And it's interesting, there's just a heavy emphasis on those midfielders.
And Jace, we noticed there from 27 through to 33, seven in a row were over 190. We got up to McBeam at 203. So the taller guys, it will take time. The clubs will take them a wee bit later.
Mind you, these days, even the midfielders are 197.
That's right.
They're getting bigger all the time.
Absolutely. So, yeah, very exciting times for a number of players. But as you said, Shifter, there's still an enormous amount of players that are hopeful to be picked up in the last handful of picks, or the last 50 picks.
Needs the ounce of luck, I think, now. Look at the name there, Tom Tomei, Paul Tomei. St Kilda supporters remember him as a defender. Back in the 80s, played 50-odd games, not eligible for father-son. Young Tommy played on you, I think, Lockie. He's a very gifted defender midfielder.
Lockie, appreciate you spending a bit of time with us, and we look forward to seeing you in action next year as a GWS Giant. Congratulations on being the number one pick.
Thanks for having me.
All right, we'll take a break. It's the 2012 NAB AFL Draft coming to you live from the Gold Coast. We'll be back with more shortly. So it's two rounds down in the 2012 NAB AFL Draft. We're about to kick off round three, and entering the fray for the first time tonight is the West Coast Eagles. Let's head back to Andrew Dimitriou.
Round three, selection 45, West Coast Eagles.
Player number 213645, Brant College, Perth and Adderdale Junior Football Club.
Selection 46.
So West Coast have entered the draft. That means just Adelaide still to come after giving up their first couple of picks. But we now have the pleasure of talking to a man that went at pick number 5 tonight, and he is now a Western Bulldog. Brad Johnson said he looks very, very good in the jump. I speak of Jake Stringer. Welcome to you, Jake, and congratulations.
Yeah, thank you.
Is it what you expected?
Yeah, it was. Nah, not really. it was a complete... When did you call me up, Shifter?
A couple of days ago.
Yeah, a couple of days ago. I was looking forward to watching it at home and then got the call up that I was coming up, so it was a complete surprise for me.
Let me ask you, as a young bloke, and for all the other blokes out there, you've spoken to X number of clubs, but you don't get too many promises. Yeah, we might do this, we might do that. It makes it difficult, doesn't it?
Yeah, it does. I suppose with my leg as well, it held a lot of clouds over everything, so I was just lucky enough to get an opportunity at the Bulldogs.
Well, tell us about that injury. It was the first round last year as a 17-year-old. You've badly broken your leg. Obviously, that put you out for the whole season.
Yeah, it did. It set me back 12 months, and then it probably has taken me another 12 months to try and get back into the same type of form I was before that.
Did you think it was over at any time when you broke your leg? And coming back from that at any stage, do you think it's going to be tough to get selected into the AFL competition?
Yeah, probably the whole time, especially times through the year when I was going through patchy stages. As Kev would know, through the Nationals and that, I had a really bad time through there. And then got the training and everything up and going, and then sort of took off from there.
Speaking of that, you went to Europe with the AS Academy, and you got named best player for Australia over there playing in France, playing against a European side.
Yeah.
Is that when you thought at that time you got some actual consistency and continuity back in your game, some good touch back in your game? Although it was against opposition that aren't great. For someone coming back off the injury you did, it must have been pleasing just to think, I can get through this.
Yeah, I was absolutely stoked, and it probably gave me a leg up for the next 3 weeks. I kicked 9 goals the week after, and it led on. It was a massive confidence booster for me.
We could see that, just the pack marking you took at that stage. You were just in a couple of contests in a row. It all seemed to click and return, and you'd put in so much work over summer. Can you recall those times, though, over the summer when you're virtually just walking laps to try and get something back into the leg?
Yeah, I mean, it was only it was a year ago when I was walking around the Kennington Res with my girlfriend and mum and dad, and I couldn't keep up with them. They were walking slow, and they're going, come on, come on. And I was standing there going, oh, I can't do it.
So what was driving you? What was the interthing driving you?
I wanted to try and make it a bit of a story for kids that get a serious injury in the championships or try and hint their career. And I wanted to make it to show people that you get a devastating injury, you can always come back from it.
Jay, we'll just get you to take a break for a minute. We're going to catch up with another top 10 draft pick. Ben Dixon has caught up with Oliver Wines.
Ollie, it's official now, number 7, Port Adelaide. It's a big move for you in a state, but a fantastic year for you, and it's just obviously credit to.
It is. All this hard work, probably not over just this last year, but the previous 3 years. And looking forward to moving to Adelaide and getting started into training and meeting all the boys, so couldn't be more happier.
And the draft itself, how did it play out? Everyone had you a little bit higher in the draft, but Port Adelaide spoke to you last night. Today, how was the information?
Oh yeah, it's a bit up in the air. You don't know, do you believe in the media, or there's a lot floating around, so I tried not to get sucked into that, and just to go along and wait for tonight. And I had a bit of a talk with the Port Adelaide recruiting team and Ken Hinckley today, and I had a fair idea tonight that I'd be ending up at Port, and over the moon and excited to get started.
As I said, Ollie, tops off a great year. Congratulations.
Thank you very much.
Yes, another top 10 draft pick. Comes with a little bit of pressure, I guess. People expect so much of those early draft picks. And have you thought about handling that sort of pressure, Jake? Because you never know how early you get an opportunity. Sometimes it takes a little while.
Yeah, I was just stoked to find myself on an AFL club. I haven't really thought about that type of stuff yet. That'd be something I'll sit down with the club and discuss with them.
What sort of conversations have you had with the Bulldogs and Brendan McCartney?
Yeah, very little. I suppose I spent my week there, so they had a pretty good understanding of me. So there's been very little talks from us. So I still had no idea if I was going there, and I was absolutely stoked when they called me out.
All right, you went at pick number 5. Let's catch up with the man that went at pick number 4, Jimmy Tumpas, with Ben Dixon.
One man we can't get the smile off the face is Jimmy Tumpas. Fantastic year for yourself, but Melbourne, I spoke to you off air, you are absolutely ecstatic.
Mate, I couldn't be happier at the moment. Yeah, I just can't wait to get out with the boys. And yeah, you're right, I couldn't get any happier at the moment.
It's a big year for you too. Captain SA, you had a fantastic carnival, but all the family here tonight, it's a special moment, isn't it?
It is, yeah. It's great to have their support, definitely. The family I'm very close with, and mum, dad, brother and sister, obviously, were sitting next to me, and it was good to have them. Then the big noise that the rest of the clan made, so it was good to have the whole Greek colony here.
I was going to say, mate, people were only allowed one table. You took up three.
Mate, I think we did. Yeah, I don't think the AFL were too happy with us, but nah, who cares?
But Melbourne itself, on the way up, and it's an exciting move for you because I know you've had a bit of a stint at Port Adelaide in terms of training. You know the professional environment, so jumping out of your skin.
Yeah, I am. Yeah, I just can't wait to get around the boys. And I've met Mark before, Nildy and Todd Viney and all them, and they all seem like great blokes. And yeah, I just can't wait to start training with the boys. Whenever they want me to head over there, I'll be there. And yeah, just look forward to getting around the boys and just embracing the Melbourne Footy Club.
Congratulations, Jimmy. Well done.
Thanks, Dico. Cheers, mate.
You can just see the excitement and the unbridled enthusiasm of all the young men that have already been drafted. It's interesting, Jake, because a lot of your mates have been drafted. You're all going to different clubs. Is there a planned celebration? You'll be ribbing each other over, can't wait till I play against you and these sorts of things?
No, I was having a bit of a joke with John O'Rourke on the plane that I told him if I was going to line up with him, we'll have a bit of a scuffle before the dance or something. But nah, it'll probably nothing happen.
Look at the Melbourne members next year too, just quickly, with Jimmy Tumpas and his family taking
the
control.
The members will be gone. They'll be full. You said Kevin gave you a call late in the piece. Were you able to get any family members up for the draft?
Yeah, I got my brother, my girlfriend and my mum and dad. So I was absolutely stoked that they could come up and be a part of it all.
So you weren't up for schoolies or anything?
No, I finished school about 3 years ago.
Shifter, I know you're keeping a close eye on the picks as they happen. Sydney have just asked for a little bit of extra time.
Yeah, interesting, isn't it? I love Mark Hutchins' selection there to the West Coast Eagles. He was a boy in St Kilda's rookie list and then dropped off after a year, went back to the Waffle and has been a fantastic player on the Waffle. Just kept at it. I know he tested brilliantly the last 2 years at state level. No fanfare, then all of a sudden he's got that chance again. I think he'll do very well for the West Coast Eagles, Mark Hutchins.
Bit of a powwow here between the power brokers at the reigning premiers, John Longmire, putting his two bobs worth in. And this is where you really have to rely on the recruiters, the guys that have seen enough of these players over and over and over. And I guess it's difficult for coaches because you can't just watch a bit of tape and say, I want him.
No, absolutely.
Because the recruiters have seen a hell of a lot more.
Well, they've been watching these players for 4 years at sometimes. And, the Kenny Beetson is a very experienced recruiter. And he'll pull the right choice out, you would expect. Just see there at pick 58, the Gold Coast Suns, Clay Cameron, who's one of the priority zone listings, who actually has already joined the Suns and went away to Arizona for just an ease into the the professional ranks.
Great to see Nick Graham, who was the big mover in the second half. He won the Morrish Medal in the TAC Cup. Jake would know him. A dominant player for Gippsland Power. Nick Stevens, who coaches down there now, has done a wonderful job with him.
Well, has he gone very late for the expectations?
I mean, 30. We all see things differently. That's the beauty of this. We don't know for certain what will happen. Of course, the fans want certainties, but there are no absolute certainties in this. So.
Jake, I don't know if Brendan McCartney had a word in your ear when he gave you the jumper. Did he say, see you Monday at pre-season training? When do you start? Because I'm sure the Bulldogs will be up and running already.
Yeah, I'm not really sure. I think we go down Monday. So, yeah, I haven't really had any talks or anything yet. I still didn't know that I was going, so I'm still in shock now. I'm stoked.
Oh, I'm loving the excitement. All right, well, round three has completed, and we'll take you through all of the selections of round three. What did you make of this round, Shifter?
Yeah, we started to get a bit of variation here with players from a little bit from left field that were picked up. Terrific to see Josh Pruden, a boy from the Murray Bushies, that late in the year really started to gather so much of the footy, playing right in the centre of the ground, a boy from Assumption College that's done very, very well with the Murray Bushies, went to the Western Bulldogs.
The third of the father-sons, Hunter has gone there, so that's really good for him.
Yeah, and I think a bit late. I reckon he was in the 30s or the 20s, the way he played late in the year. A left-footer, a son of Mark Hunter, Lockie Hunter, a real great ball gatherer, and hits that scoreboard.
And I noticed, Jace, the utilities are starting to come into the fore as well.
A big thank you to Jake Stringer, pick number 5, who is now a Western Bulldog. But great to spend a bit of time with you. Loving the enthusiasm you're showing. Can't wait to see you tuck into. I'm sure we're going to see you in action next year. Thanks for spending a bit of time with
Thank
us.
Thank you.
All right, we'll take a break here at the Gold Coast. Back with more draft selections in just a moment. Welcome back to the 2012 NAB AFL Draft. Rounds 4 through 7 you'll see start to really flow now. There's a lot of pre-selections and promoted rookies that will come to the fore in these selections. Don't forget you can hit the red button if you want to watch each and every selection live. But right now we're going to have a chat to another Bulldog. We just spoke to Jake Stringer, pick number 5. Pick number 6 was Jackson McRae. Welcome to you, Jackson.
Thanks for having me, boys.
Now, were you expecting to be a Bulldog tonight?
No, not at all. So, very relieved to be in, stay in Melbourne and to be at a great up-and-coming club like the Bulldogs.
Well, that's interesting because you've obviously come here and you're hoping to get drafted. You know you're going to get drafted, but you really weren't sure. So you're there. Am I going interstate? Yeah. Which club am I going to? You were completely in the dark.
Yeah, definitely. You know, listening to all the different scenarios and stuff and just tried to stay out of it and my head will explode if I try and figure it all out. So just tried to keep away from all the mock drafts and all the talk and stuff and just, you know, I couldn't do anything about it and just relax with my mates and stuff like that.
Now, you've had a fantastic season. Last year, I suppose, was a little bit disappointing for you. You weren't getting a game at Oakley. That's an unusual situation to be in.
Yeah, definitely. Being at Oakley, it was very frustrating training with them the whole year and seeing how pumped up they were for the finals and stuff like that. I think really helped drive me this year and, seeing Toby Green, how well he progressed after being in a very similar situation as to I was. So I took a great confidence out of that and put my best foot forward for this year.
That left leg goes pretty well, doesn't it? You, I think, kicked 6 goals against the Tasmanian boys earlier in the season.
Yeah, no, that was great to get on a couple of cheapies, I guess, and hit the scoreboard well.
So and the winning point this year in the grand final as well. But you mentioned you've just completed year 12. So how did you go with the exams, knowing that the draft was coming up as well and your future was going to be decided tonight?
Yeah, it was very difficult balancing it all and stuff. And Kerry, where I'm at school, was very great throughout the year, balancing school and footy. And it was very difficult at times, training 4 or 5 times a week and then getting up to do study and stuff. But I did my best, I guess.
Stick with us, Jackson, but we're going to catch up now with a man that is going to be playing at Collingwood next year at pick number 18, Brodie Grundy. And Ben Dixon's caught up with him.
Here with Brodie Grundy, big year for yourself. You've been in the academy for a couple of years and touted as the best ruckman in the land, lucky enough to land it at Collingwood.
Yeah, obviously it's a massive honour and I feel really privileged to be part of the biggest and the best club in Australia, and just really looking forward to working hard. All the work is ahead of me and I know that, and just really looking forward to getting amongst it.
And leaving Adelaide, Collingwood picked up 3 Adelaide people with their first 3 picks, so it's obviously some friends there, but you yourself, you'll embrace any environment?
Yep. I'm not fussed. I was never fussed about it. Obviously, you take the opportunity, but I'm good mates with Ben Kennedy especially, and Timmy Broomhead both got picked up, so just really excited about that. I'm good mates with them. I was hoping, me and Kenno were joking around saying, well, imagine if we went to the same club, and it's happened, so we're just stoked.
And in terms of the draft coming in, did you have any idea Collingwood were obviously going to take you at that, or was it going to be earlier? Other clubs talked to you?
If it was going to be Collingwood, I would have said Collingwood would be the last. I spoke to them probably once at the start of the year, here I am now, so it's a big surprise, but it's a great surprise, I tell you. Yeah,
you're gonna run with the headband at Collingwood?
I'll see how I go. My boys might put me down a little bit, but I'll see how I go. Yeah,
get a few tats and join Swanee.
I don't know, it's probably a bit too young at the moment.
All right, Brodie, congratulations.
Yes, thanks.
It's interesting, isn't it? We're starting to see some players that really didn't know where they were going. These are ruckmen that have been drafted top 10 over the last 10 years or so. And we were just talking about ruckman a little bit earlier. Shifted, been a heavy shift towards midfielders and more ready-made players. But a number of these have gone on to be terrific players. There's a few that, for whatever reason, really haven't risen to what we thought they might.
I suppose the things that, how long it'll take, it's a 4 to 5 year project now. So I think a lot of it tend to be taken as rookies. And they'll train for the senior group. There's no difference, but they probably won't play in the senior team. So that's the way it'll tend to go, and that rookie draft's a couple of weeks away.
Well, it seems to be a trend now. Mature your ruckman at another club, then go and pinch him afterwards. I mean, we noticed, I'm not sure, we haven't been able to watch the whole of the draft as it goes through, Kevin, but Billy Longa was overlooked last year by GWS. We thought maybe they might pinch a young ruckman for their structure. Have they gone with one this year so far?
I'd need to have another look. Another look at their little grouping, but certainly they've got a fairly good ruck contingent, I think, with the guys they've got.
Well, we're talking with Jackson McRae, who went pick number 6 for the Western Bulldogs.
Who could near be a ruckman? I mean, you play on the wing. How tall are you?
Just 189. So
just 189.
Yeah. How do you feel, physically speaking, in terms of, we're talking about ruckmen that take a while to develop? When can you see yourself, and it might be round one next year, slotting into senior footy?
You know, definitely you aspire to play round one next year, and being at the Bulldogs with a developing young list, you know, I definitely want to play senior footy next year, and I'm going to be working towards that as the main goal. But, you know, a lot of stuff to go between now and round one, and definitely going to hit the gym and get a lot bigger and build my body up to develop an inside game as well.
Let's catch up with another top 10 pick in Nick Vlosten, who ended up as a Richmond player, and Diggo's caught up with him.
Nick, nice reception when Damien Harwick gives you a big hug on stage. Welcome to the Tigerland. Fantastic.
Thank you very much. He said to my parents I was shaking a bit, so it's good to be down there.
It's nice to have another hard midfielder, half-backer in his sights, but you must be absolutely ecstatic. You had a great year this year, and everyone touted you as the leader and obviously the mature type that could step straight in. It's obviously a big day.
Yeah, massive day. You know, I've been waiting for a while for it. Obviously not with school this year. I've had a lot of time just sitting at home thinking about it, and it's good it's finally over. I was, didn't get much sleep last night, so it's all good.
How nervous sitting there knowing you could have gone earlier, it was up in the air who it was going to be. Richmond spoke to you late, and how was it sitting there?
Yeah, very nerve-wracking. I was, couldn't sit still, you know, sweating and all that. Just proud for the other boys, but you know, just sitting there thinking when's my turn and all that. So.
The family Richmond supporters?
Nah, Dad's Sydney and Mum doesn't go for anyone, but I'm Collingwood, so just across the road.
That's all right, mate. They can change to Richmond. Well done.
Cheers, thanks, Dad. Okay.
There is nothing better than just seeing these excited young men about to embark on an AFL journey. Jackson, you obviously watch a lot of AFL. You've seen the Bulldogs. How do you see them placed? What sort of direction do you think they're headed in?
Yeah, definitely. They're probably not aspiring to play finals next season or two, but they've got some great young players developing, and you know, probably 2014, 2015, with the young group they've got coming through, and picking up Jake Stringer definitely helps as well. And yeah, definitely finals in a few years.
At what stage of the year did you think I'm a chance? Because the year before you didn't get a game with Oakley. This year you started to play. At what stage did it click for you?
Probably after the Nationals, I started to actually think about it and work towards the draft. I guess going through pre-season and each game, I just tried to focus for that game and not really think about anything else and play as best as I could and hopefully get noticed. So probably after Nationals.
Yeah, you've got a number of mates that probably haven't been drafted yet and we're getting late in the draft. Did you try to get your mind around the fact that you mightn't be picked up, or did you really get a handle over the last month with the focus on you that you were definitely going to get drafted? Was there any thought in the back of your mind that this mightn't turn out?
Over probably at the start of the year, definitely. Yeah. I was working really hard to hopefully get noticed and picked up, and you know, there's a lot of players that disappointingly won't get picked up, and you know, I'm sure my mates that won't get picked up will bounce back and, you know, work for the next year.
David King was your coach a couple of years ago at school. Did he have an impact on you at all?
Yeah, no, he was great in my year 11 year, not making the Oakley squad. He gave me great confidence, working with me very individually at Kerry Grammar, and gave me a lot of confidence and helped me to back myself and really take the game on, and that's really one of the main things I focused on this year.
So once Kingy wasn't coaching you, you kicked on and started to level. That's cleared that up very nicely.
Let's keep Kingy's spell for a moment. Jesse Lonergan is off to the Gold Coast, and our boy Diggo's caught up with him.
Jesse, pretty happy Gold Coast, sun and surf from Tasmania. It's going to be a big change for you.
Yeah, definitely. You know, from 12 degree heat to now 30-odd, so you know, I'm pretty excited over the moon, and I just can't wait to get into it.
Yeah, any ideas coming in? I've asked a number of the boys, and it was a bit of a lottery for them. Yeah. Gold Coast, obviously extremely interested, but other clubs as well?
Yeah, well, you know, you don't like a lot of the boys, you don't know. They hold their cards pretty tight, like I was saying to you before, you know, kind of left in the dark, and you just got to wait for your name to get called out. But it's great. It's an amazing experience.
Big string to your bow with the year you had. Fantastic. Do you actually have a surfboard?
No, don't actually. I might have to invest in one, but we went camping a couple of weeks ago and I tried to surfing at it, but no good. I was just falling off left, right and centre. So.
Had a good chat to Guy McKenna. Settled yourself in a little bit?
Yeah, had a chat with him and a few of the other boys at back. I'm excited to be on board and I'm excited that they give me an opportunity. I just can't wait to get right into it.
Well, it's a big night for you and congratulations.
Thank you, Ben. Thank you.
Yes, I think Dicko's enjoying this too. He's acting 18 all over again. Jackson, just talking about clubs encourage players to do things outside of footy. And I certainly think it's incredibly important. What are your interests, whether it's educational, business-wise? What do you want to do outside of football?
Outside of football, I've already applied to commerce at Deakin University, and staying in Melbourne definitely helps that, so I can go to uni in Melbourne, and definitely I want to go down the tertiary education path.
Happy to hear that. We always like to know that players are doing things outside of football. We just heard a round of applause. That is the wrapping up of the 2012 NAB AFL Draft. So, as I mentioned, rounds 4 through 7, they really do roll through pretty quickly. Some teams start to pass. There are just some pre-selections and some promoted rookies and those sorts of things. Shifter, what did you make of the lower picks? This is where the sleepers come in.
Yeah, and I think we should celebrate the selection of Majak Dawe. Yeah. He's been a rookie for three years, but he's the first Sudanese boy to make it onto a primary list of an AFL club.
His preliminary final was fantastic for Werribee against Geelong, where he nearly won the game for him in the last quarter.
His highlight reel in the VFL has been sensational, as it was with the Western Jets earlier on, but he's now strung it together and they made him really earn his spot. But he's an exciting player for the North Melbourne Footy Club.
And an exciting player for the Western Bulldogs is Jackson McRae. We thank you for spending a bit of time with us. Jono's beside himself. He's had a couple of young Bulldogs there, so thank you very much for your time. It's just interesting watching these latter rounds roll through, isn't it? And we spoke about some of the players that went in the really low numbers, some of the best players the competition's ever seen. So you can't just write them off as thinking, oh, we're not going to get anything deep in the draft, because it does happen.
It does happen. You get some particular athletes into a professional environment, they really thrive, whereas it probably hasn't worked for them in a TAC Cup, or maybe they've been country kids.
Yep.
Or certainly you see in the developing states of New South Wales and Queensland, that haven't got the depth of talent to play with each week. So they're the guys that can come in late, maybe even 19 or 20, and develop.
All right, don't go away. After the break, we'll look at all the events of tonight's draft and what it means for your club. Welcome back to the Gold Coast Convention and Exhibition Centre. The 2012 NAB AFL Draft has been completed. All the selections have been made. Very shortly, we'll go through each of the individual clubs so you know exactly who you have got coming to your club next season. But right now, a man that you'd think would be on top of the world, he's just won the 2012 Premiership, but work never stops if you want to stay on top. John Longmire, coach of the Sydney Swans. Welcome to your horse.
Thanks, James.
Have you come down off the magnificent high at the end of September yet?
Oh, you come down pretty quickly, I guess. You've got to get on with the job. And, you know, we enjoyed it, as you'd expect. We had a great time, but work starts pretty much straight away, so you've got to be focused on the next year always.
It does come around quickly. I want to ask you about a couple of things. First and foremost, I think you're the only senior coach we saw on the front table. Most of the others tended to sit at the back and have their two bobs worth there. What was the reasoning behind that?
No deliberate ploy, Joe. So it was about halfway through and I realised I was sitting up the front. I was the only one there. So I think it was a bit superstition in regards to where he wanted me to sit. So nothing
started with that last year. Win the flag. Got to continue.
Everyone's going to be in the same spot now. Well, tell us about Sydney's philosophy heading into this draft.
We wanted to get some real speed in, some good size, and we think we've done that. Our first selection, Dean Towers, a 22-year-old from Ballarat, who has got really good size, really good speed. We go through to Harrison Marsh, our second selection, is a WA kid who's got good size as well. A country boy, Tim Membry, we just thought was too good a player to pass up at the selection that we had, and Matthew Dick, another one with real pace. So we think we've got a combination of good size and good pace into our club.
Is this the anticipation with these four players that they could come in and play next year?
Oh, I guess it's really hard to know. I've seen them on tape, but until you see them live, you don't know what their size is and how their work ethic is. We think they're all good kids, which is important. Kenny really rates them as kids. So, we really think that they're all good kids will come in and work hard. So, who knows?
Three players for the half-back line. Is that a transition sort of thinking?
Well, I think they're certainly players that can come in and play that role for us, and that's important. We've got some experienced players in our defence. We've got a couple of younger ones like Alex Johnson, who played in the grand final this year, but a couple of experienced ones, and you always got to have an eye to the future.
So, Shifter, as we look at the selections that Sydney did make, I know horse is right next to you, so don't be bashful about how you rate it, Shifter. What do you think of the talent that the Swans have picked up?
Well, I love Tim Memory as a player, a 189 forward that has got the best hands in the business and it kicks it from outside 50. So I think very suited to the SCG in particular. So I had him in 30, so I reckon a bonus. I'm interested in just the process, the coach. How deep do you get involved with your recruiting people in coming up with your list?
Yeah, ultimately it's always the recruiting people that make the call. I mean, we sit there over a period of a couple of weeks and go through all those players, and you know, you might go through 70 odd players, and our match committee sits down and goes through it and talks about where the game's at now, where the game could be going, and it's really good to have that interaction with our recruiting department. So we get a good idea of what players we're looking at. I really enjoy this time of the year, looking at the younger kids. We had four kids playing the grand final, 21 or younger, so we thought that, you know, it's a really important part of our footy club, the draft, obviously, and I like to get involved in it, but obviously the recruiting man's the one that makes the call.
And you've got a pretty good record in the 40s, you know. Luke Parker might have been a 42 choice.
Adam Goods was.
Yeah, Adam Goods, again. You know, Lachlan, we heard him talk earlier. He was up around the 40 mark. So yeah.
Sam Reed wasn't far away. He was in the late 40s as well. So with that philosophy, who, obviously you're going for the bigger body players and taller. Who has the final call on the type?
Well, it's always a combination of just a discussion. It's never this one or the other. We always talk about the type of players we think is required at AFL level, but Kinnear's the one that always makes the final call, and he's been very good, and we trust his judgment.
Yep. All right, if you've just joined us, the 2012 NAB AFL Draft has been completed. Let's go back and recap the top 10 selections from this season. GWS with the first three picks. No surprise to see Lockie Whitfield, Jonathan O'Rourke, and Lachlan Plowman heading to GWS. Jimmy Tumpas, a lot of excitement about him going to Melbourne. The Bulldogs had a couple of top 10 picks, so a little bit of everything there, and clubs that desperately need some good quality youngsters into their mix.
Yeah, Oliver Wines there going in the finish to Port Adelaide at 7. Well, Ken Hinckley was talking to him at 1 o'clock this afternoon, so things do happen even at the last minute.
This is interesting. Here are the feeder clubs. Balder Cannons, very, very good breeding ground this season, with 7 of their players being selected.
Strong input into the draft, and Dan Inong Stingrays have had a fantastic injection into the AFL over the last few years with another 4.
And 4 number ones, but Dan Inong Stingrays with Lockie getting up. That's a magnificent effort in 27 years.
All right, Horace, we'll let you get about your work. We know, you know, you're a very busy man, one premiership, you're already thinking about the next. Thanks for spending a few minutes with us, and good luck for season 2012.
Thanks, guys. Thank you.
Right now, we're going to go through each of the individual clubs, kicking off with Adelaide. We'll do it in alphabetical order. So these are the selections by the Crows. Don't forget, they handed back picks 20 and 54 in anticipation of some punishment they're going to cop from the AFL next week over the Kurt Tippett target. So Sam Siggins at 62 was their first selection.
And a 195-centimetre key defender did well there. And Rory Atkins, the best and fairest winner from the Calder Cannons, that great producer of talent, they got done very well to get him so late.
It's an interesting moment now, because this is where everyone gets up and starts talking to each other. All the different clubs have a look. Who did you get? Slipped us. We were going to get him. Spewing that you took that bloke.
Well, ironically, we talk about Sam Siggins. I know the Sydney Swans were really keen on him as a key defender. And so Adelaide Crows would be pretty happy to get him at 62.
Let's move on to the Brisbane Lions now. See exactly who they selected in this year's draft. They came in at pick 8. Sam Mays, an exciting midfield forward from North Adelaide. But 3 picks in the top 32, that's not bad.
And Paparone, a tall guy that I really like. He's worked through the midfield even at 192. He's got an elite running ability and close as a tall forward.
And speaking of their first selection there, Ben Dixon has caught up with Sam Mays.
Sam, very excited. SA boy going to the Brisbane Lions, but anywhere will do, won't it?
Yeah, oh, definitely. Very excited with the opportunity to go up and play for the Brisbane Lions, and I'm very thankful that they've given me it. So pretty keen to get stuck into it and head up Sunday and go from there, yeah.
Do you have any idea coming into the draft? Brisbane obviously had a chat to you at some stage, but other clubs were pretty interested and had no idea?
No, I had no idea. I spoke to Brisbane earlier on in the year and then again at draft camp, but apart from that, I didn't really speak to them too much. So yeah, it was a good surprise, and I'm looking forward to it. So,
family over the moon?
Yeah, well, I shed a tear with mum and dad when they heard the news, and it was all exciting. So they're proud of me, and yeah, so it's exciting times, and can't wait to get stuck into it.
Well, you're going to a proud club, Sam, so congratulations and good luck for the future.
Thanks, mate. Cheers.
I'm amazed at the number of players that really genuinely didn't know where they were going. But Lynchy, I think Brisbane would be pretty satisfied with what they've picked up in the draft.
Yeah, an extremely talented player. So looking forward to seeing him make an impact, I think, next year. He's obviously a player that can go through the midfield, kick goals as well. So, no, an exciting player for the Brisbane Lions.
Well, Carlton entered the draft at pick number 11. And the Blues will be looking for plenty from this lot, Troy Menzel. We know he's from pretty good stock shifter, isn't he?
Yeah, Daniel, of course, at Geelong. And this guy's a left-footer. Mercurial Menzel, I call him, because he can do anything. He wins great contested footy. 187, medium forward, but can come through the midfield. And prolific goal kicker.
Kick nine in the first championship game.
Six in the next. After that.
I think his first game back from injury as well. I mean, an exciting player's had the Lars reconstruction at the age of 16. Yeah. So,
that's
been
the
a lot of speculation.
One, isn't it? I mean, you're going to see here that he's a very good mover. He uses the ball beautifully. He's a clever player. But you just have that in the back of your mind, if young kids that have had the Lars surgery, you just wonder how, because they're not proving to have lasted for a really long time.
No, and especially with the family issues. Obviously, his brother's had the knee problems as well. So, yeah, I mean, there has been a few issues over the Lars reconstruction. He's very happy with it. It's very stable, and hopefully it's not a trend that continues. But he's a very exciting player. Just a dangerous, potent player in the forward half that can go in the midfield as well. So can't wait to see him play next year.
Well, if you cast your mind back, when we got to the end of round one, Kevin Sheehan said Collingwood are the big winners. They had three picks back to back, and they picked up some great talent there. Brody Grundy at 18, Ben Kennedy 19, and Timothy Broomhead at 20. Also Jackson Ramsey at 38. And Marley Williams, upgraded at 94.
And they've certainly gone interstate. Haven't picked Victorians, they've picked Broomhead. We haven't mentioned him. He's a midfielder from the Port Magpies that had no trouble stepping up to senior level after having a very good under-18 series. He's got that beautiful step through traffic.
Shifter, how much does that go-home factor come into consideration when you're looking at who you're going to draft and how many interstate kids you draft?
Look, most of the boys will go anywhere. I think half the boys in the draft actually shift states, but most are pretty comfortable to go where the AFL takes them. There's just the odd one that might have some issues.
I don't think that's a major issue for relocating players to Melbourne. You often find, you're a case in point, relocating to Melbourne, you don't see too many players leave Melbourne.
It's more the Melbourne players that head interstate and want to come home.
Absolutely, especially to the developing states, hard to retain those.
And the Pies' first three picks have all had senior experience this year, so they come into the competition from South Australia with that senior experience behind them.
Yep. All right, next up, it's the Essendon Football Club.
Well, they've had a fantastic start, and I'd be interested with Joe Danaher as the father-son signing at pick 10. In a normal draft, Kevin, Joe Danaher, where would he sit tonight if he wasn't signed under the father-son rule?
We'd be debating Lachie Whitfield and Joe Danaher as one and two, which one should have been.
He is
an outstanding prospect. He has been for a couple of years. He's grown to 201. That's 6'7", 6'8", and was talked about. He's like Paul Salmon. They couldn't get near Paul at his best, and this boy's like that with his great reach for the mark in a pack and a lovely long left-foot kick. Agility, amazing for a guy of this size, so he really will excite the Bomber fans.
All right, well, they've picked up some interesting talent, and Ben Dixon has tracked down James Hurd to find out what he thinks of Essendon's selections.
Hurdy, plenty of selections, two 21-year-olds and four, obviously, 18-year-olds.
Yeah, look, we need a bit of balance there, and we sort of started the draft with Joe Danaher, which is an excellent start for us, knowing we're going to get that. And then moved into Jason Ashby, you know, very good halfback flanker out of Oakley Chargers, and Kerry Grammer, so very excited to have him there. Dylan Van Noonan out of the Frankston Football Club, 21-year-old, a bit more mature, and you know, we'd expect him to play in the next year or two. Marty Gleeson, who's a young kid out of Koroit, and then also North Ballarat, so highly skillful player. Then Nick Comer, a kid from Perth who's been training with us the last couple of weeks, very impressive 21-year-old. And then Sean Gregory, a Dustin Fletcher prototype, we hope. 196 centimetres, still growing, very raw, but you know, something for the future.
Fletcher reckons he's got four more years, so he's got four years of development.
Perfect, yeah. Fletcher's got at least four more, so it's absolutely perfect.
Good on you, Hurdy. Thanks for your time.
Thanks, mate. See ya.
A good balance of young and old on the Essendon list. Fremantle came into this year's draft with pick 17 as their first selection, and they took a young East Fremantle player, midfield forward type, Joshua Simpson.
Yeah, Josh Wilson, a very classy player too, that can come off half-back or run through the midfield, an Indigenous boy. He just sees that little bit of grass inside a pack and takes off and backs himself. Great acceleration. Tanner Smith's a tall defender from the North Ballarat Rebels, can play on the big tall forwards. Max Duffy, great to see him. Overlooked for the last couple of drafts. And get a guy that then kicked 33 goals at senior level in the Waffle this year, and it really has earned that spot on the Fremantle list.
And Jono, we're familiar with the bottom two names, Clancy Pearce and Lee Spurgess being upgraded there.
Well, especially Clancy Pearce had an impact in the competition this year, so he was able to help Fremantle through the midfield go to another level.
Well, we know that the Geelong Football Club has kept a fantastic list together for many, many years. They're starting to inject some good young players in. Jackson Thurlow was their prize pick at number 16. And it'd be interesting to see what sort of dividends they reap from a couple of late ones in Bradley Hartman at 77 and Jesse Stringer at 92.
I think done well with Jackson Thurlow, an All-Australian defender this year playing in deep defence, but he can also push up through the midfield. The second boy from Launceston, taken in the teens. Fantastic for the statewide league over there in Tassie. Jesse Stringer upgraded. He was a guy that really shown he had the ability to play at the senior level early in the year.
See Neil Balm there just chatting about things. We heard from James Hurd talking about Essendon's picks. I wonder what Chris Scott thinks of Geelong's picks.
Chris, two selections, an upgraded rookie. Pretty happy with the selections?
Yeah, we think so. With our first pick, we took Jackson Thurlow, a Tasmanian boy. He was an All-Australian under 18 this year. Really flexible player. Not quite a key position player, but a tall flanking type player that we think can push into the midfield as well. And then with a later pick, Brad Hartman from Murray Bridge, who's more of a project player, hasn't played a lot of football, has played a lot of basketball, and we think there's a fair bit of upside in him. So together with our upgraded rookie, Jesse Stringer, we think that it should put us in reasonable shape to improve next year.
And you mentioned project player. Speculation at your list at times that you've got to rebuild, but you keep delivering. Obviously some serious depth within your list.
Yeah, we'd like to think so. I mean, we are under no illusions that our list is going to look very different in 4 or 5 years. So we need to prepare well for the future. And we think we've taken some steps towards doing that in the last couple of years. But we still think we've got some talent on our list that can perform in the short term.
Appreciate your time, Scotty.
No worries. Thanks, Dicko.
Now, I reckon one team that's flowing under the radar a little bit is the Gold Coast Suns. We know they came in a couple of years ago and they got some outstanding talent. No one's spoken about them. First pick, 13, Jesse Lonergan. What do you make of this mix?
I like his power, this boy. He's a stopping star. Yeah. Absolute powerful away from the contest. And he's a boy that had injuries early in the year, come back late in the National 18s and shown his class around the footy.
Speaking to Jesse throughout the year, he used to hate recovery down in Tassie because it was that cold in the water. He's going to be that happy. He's going to be in the water every single day up on the Gold Coast.
It's interesting, Lindsay. What are we expecting from Gold Coast next season? Because these players have been on the list for a few years now. We know they've got more quality youngsters coming in. It's time to turn potential into some wins at some
Absolutely.
Stage, isn't it?
And we've got to remember that the young bodies have gone up there. They've had two and sometimes three pre-seasons now, so they're starting to develop. See Malcolm Blight, obviously the football director at the Gold Coast Suns, just having a chat to the recruiting staff about how he went. But I think they've got some really good players that are going to emerge after that third season, pre-season under their belt. So signs.
Talk about your good lists. GWS, what have they done over the last couple of seasons? Another top three picks here, five in the top 15. It is excitement all round, isn't it?
The ones we haven't mentioned, Christian Jacks at 12. He's the ultimate swing man, probably the best of the centre-half forward, centre-half back types. A ripper there. Aidan Courgier, 195 centimetre, tall defender with brilliant speed. So he'll close someone down there. Hard to find those guys that can play out of the goal square, play a disciplined role, and that's where Aidan Courgier will fit in.
You know the depth they're starting to develop up forward already, GWS, so a lot of their picks are midfield back this year.
So this is the man you're talking about, Shifter?
This is Jacks, the guy that can play at either end. He kicked six goals against Tassie. We've seen him early in the year playing deep defence. A magnificent kick and a guy that, again, wasn't a star last year. So he's really come on and he's 18th year at the Oakley Chargers.
That's the man overseeing everything that happens at GWS. I've got to tell you, there aren't many clubs that have those quality swingmen now, the ones that can have an impact at both ends. We probably saw them more through the 80s and 90s, but these days, gee, they're invaluable. This is probably the club that has the most interest in the competition.
Oh, that's right.
Just joking. Tim O'Brien from Glenelg was their first pick at 28. Then at 66 and 70, well, 70, they redrafted Michael Osborne, who's coming back from a knee reconstruction. So great to see Ozzy back on the list there. And Caden Brand another Adelaide player from West Adelaide, a forward slash ruckman.
Also a big body in, and you've done well as you have in past years with the trade period as well. So obviously Brian Lake comes in to really add some experience to the younger players that have been drafted.
All right, let's hear from Alistair Clarkson and see what he thought of Hawthorn's three picks.
Clarko, two selections, 18-year-old kids, probably development players, but Adelaide boys.
Yeah, listen, they're telling young fellas. Tank Morris, our recruiting guy in the South Oz, he's recommended a couple of really good lads for us. So they're tallish, angular types, you know, one in Tim O'Brien, who's predominantly a forward, and another guy, Caden Brand, who can play forward and back, but he's got a bit of height. He's about 198, so... we'll just have to wait and see how they progress over the next couple of years. But we're really excited with those two picks, and the old veteran Aussie, we've taken him back with our third pick. So it's good to get three guys back into our club.
And Brian Lake, great addition to the back line. And I mean, the list has obviously got an enormous depth, but he just adds links.
Yeah, listen, we've identified that we needed that sort of bigger, stronger type to play in those big gorillas down back, and you know, he's proven player in that position, so hopefully he can get his body right and play another 3 or 4 years of AFL footy. And if he does that, we think we're going to be really competitive at the end of the year. But we also picked up a young kid in our trade period, Jed Anderson, who's a young Aboriginal boy from Darwin, and he was part of the Gillam trade to GWS. So we're really pleased with that pickup as well, and pleased that Gilly and Murph get opportunities at other clubs, but also pleased that we've been able to inject a little bit of youth into our club too.
Thanks for your time, Clarko.
Good on you, Diggo. See you, mate.
It's interesting, we spoke earlier that Ben Jacobs got picked up from Port Adelaide, but not too many other of the experienced AFL players found a second home. Here's what Melbourne did. We spoke to Jimmy Tumpas earlier on. Big family, very excited about him coming to Melbourne. Jack Viney under the father's son, and they went deep into the draft, the Dees.
Well, they did, and went very deep, but their top two picks are class midfielders that will play next year, I would have thought, Kev.
Oh, and Jack Viney, he loves the competitive footy, he loves the contest, he will bury the guy if the guy gets it before he does at the clearances, so, and he's a leader as well.
That's the future right there, because you've got Jack who gets it, Jimmy on the outside predominantly who will run the line, so they're going to link up for many years at Melbourne.
Let me ask you a question, Shifter, and it was hotly debated coming into the draft whether one of the clubs would bid with a really early pick for Jack Viney and force Melbourne to use pick number 4 on him. If... GWS or bid one of those early draft picks and said, we'll take him unless you take him with your first pick, what would Melbourne have done, do you think?
I think they would have taken him. But in the finish, the Gold Coast Suns had the live pick that they could have used.
Yeah.
The Giants wanted to keep it for Whitfield. So at 2, they decided in the finish that Jack Martin was the guy they wanted for the mini draft. So they gave up that pick.
Traded
and as soon as they wanted to do that, Melbourne were safe and they're able to get Viney.
So it's a steal at 26.
It's a steal. He would have been in the top half a dozen.
Absolutely a steal at 26.
All right, here's what North Melbourne has done. Taylor Garner was their first pick at pick number 15. And as we mentioned, Majak Dore now on the senior list.
Taylor Hine from the Gold Coast Suns.
That's 9 selections there. Yes. Look, there's
three
a couple
elevated
already
rookie
on the list. Sam Gibson, of course.
And Taylor Garner, mercurial player, all Australian again from mid-year, no air last year. He's a boy that just come on this year, and he was that good in the Nationals playing for Vic Country that was a certain draftee. Then a shoulder injury kept him out of it late in the year, so it was just in 10 games, most of the clubs had him right on the radar in around that mark. So an exciting mercurial marking forward.
We just saw the North Melbourne hierarchy there, and Ben Dixon has caught up with their coach, Brad Scott.
Brad, we're lucky to have you awake. Flew in from Utah for the draft and flying out in the morning. It's a big schedule.
Yeah, I tried to convince the boys to put the cardboard and cut out at the table because that's really all I do on the draft day. I'm just here for looks. But no, a tough schedule, but it's got to be done.
6 picks. What was North coming in to the draft looking for? Were they obviously bolster your depth in terms of defence, forward? What were you looking for?
Oh, no, we were looking to really add some A-grade talent, with our first pick. And Taylor Garner definitely does that. We rated him really highly, so really pleased to get him. Ben Jacobs is obviously someone we targeted for a while. Couldn't get the trade done, but now we sit here really pleased that we've got Taylor Garner with our first pick, and someone we rate essentially in Ben Jacobs as another first round pick. So those two selections were great, and then Mason Wood and Wilkins with our next two picks was a bonus. We thought that We had to make those decisions earlier if we're going to get them in. So to get them with our third and fourth pick was just great. And then, you know, some mature age players in Daniel Curry to add to our ruck stocks is really pleasing. And Taylor Hine from the Gold Coast is a small defender. So, you know, and then three upgraded rookies. So it's been a busy night for us, but, you know, we really think we've added to our list.
Exciting young players. So good luck for the future, Scotty.
Thanks, Dicko. Cheers, mate.
Ken Hinckley is a man with a big job ahead of him, the new coach of the Port Adelaide Football Club. Jono, what did you make of their participation in the draft?
Well, Oliver Wines is an outstanding young player. Enough has been said about him this year so far, and including tonight. Mason Shaw, a big forward, had his jaw broken earlier in the year, so was able to respond on the back of that. He's had his challenges, but able to stand up and play some good footy late in the year, Shifter.
Yes, and Thomas Cleary there, a 192 centimetre tall defender from the Murray Bushes and from Catamus High, right up there in the Murray, and a very, very big tank, this guy, the guy that outran everyone in that deep test. At that size, this bloke will keep going all day.
Where did you say Catamatite?
Catamatite. Darren Flanagan comes from there, if you mean the big Darren that played at Geelong and St Kilda.
Should have known you'd know all those sorts of things.
It's a little tiny spot.
Let's move on to the Richmond Football Club. We saw Damien Hardwick up on stage presenting the Richmond jumper to Nick Flaston, who was their first selection inside the top 10, and they've had four picks there, haven't you?
Absolutely, and Flaston sounds like he's a really hard player from the Northern Knights. Good leadership qualities, plays across halfback, and Jono, you've seen a lot of him. He's really come on since he went to the back line and played down back pocket particularly.
Yeah, he has, and that was his challenge, because throughout the midfield, he just wasn't getting out of the contest enough, and he went back to find some form, went back to the back pocket to be able to do that, and then he competes. So that's why it was the best position for him to go back and just beat an opponent, get his confidence back that way, found his run again, and then towards the end of the year went back up into the midfield.
There's Brendan Gale, the CEO of the Tigers, and their coach is Damien Hardwick. Let's hear from him now.
Damien, four selections. Your first was probably your best, I reckon. I followed him all year, Nick Flaston. Hard as a cat's head. He's in and under the way you like it.
Yeah, we're very excited. He's obviously a very tough player, a guy that can use the ball really well. He's got great leadership qualities. So, look, he'll slot straight into our side, and we're very excited to bring him on board.
Coming into it, you're looking at, obviously, ready-made players. What was the plan of attack? You know, what do you think? You wanted to, obviously, bolster your depth. What was the draft after?
Yeah, look, there's a number of things. Obviously, we needed a ruckman at some stage. We obviously lost a couple over, you know, the off-season. So to bring in Lee McBean, you know, he's 202 centimetres. He's got outstanding skills. I was quite surprised he was a ruckman. I watched his highlight package. You know, we've got two other boys, Camden McIntosh, who thinks he's going to be an outstanding player. He's 192 centimetre, like, wingman type, half-back, which we're very excited about bringing in. And young Matthew McDonough, who's a Paul Chapman clone, we think. So if he can be that good, we'd be very, very happy. So, look, we've certainly addressed some needs of our footy club and brought in some incredible talent. So very excited.
Good luck for the future, Dimmer.
Thanks, Dicko. Cheers, mate.
We saw the Saints take a little bit of extra time on at least one occasion tonight over their selections. They had picks 24 and 25 to kick things off. Nathan Wright and Spencer White expected to be good players there, but a number of picks for the Saints as well.
And Lewis Pearce, the ruckman. We're right at the time we're talking about ruckman. Yep. Tony Elshaw called his name out, so he'll take time. But he played for Vic Country this year. I like some of his work. He got some pace here. Saunders is a dasher. We talked about him. Brody Murdoch's brother is Jordan, the boy down at Geelong, that is really quick, and so's Brody. So I think they're very well with their selections there, the Saints.
All right, for Saints fans, let's now have a listen to their coach, Scotty Waters, talking about the draft.
Foxions, a couple of talls, a few smalls in there, a bit of a mixed bag.
It is a mixed bag, which is probably addressing a number of different needs across our list. So big Pearce, 202 centimetre ruckman, plenty of talent. We're about to have him on board. We've got three different types of mids in Murdoch, Saunders, one more. Nathan Wright, really, really aggressive sort of halfback wing type. So it is a really good mix for us, and we're really pleased. But also adding to our forward stocks as well, another 194 centimetre in Spencer White, who's just got an outstanding set of hands. So some real talent there as well. So we're excited to get him on board.
Well, we relish with Revolt and Kaczynski up there. Another tall into that mix. Be a potent forward line.
Yeah, we're probably getting some good depth in that area as well. Picking up Tom Lee, you know, obviously as well. Another 194 centimetre athletic type. So got some options up there. Obviously developing options, but certainly address some needs.
He had a cracker year, Tom Lee at Claremont, and I think he'd be a good one for the future, Scotty, and congratulations.
Good on you, Benny. Thanks, mate.
Well, we spoke to John Longmire a short time ago, but we will recap the Sydney selections once again. Dean Towers, 22-year-old, John was saying, so they're excited about him coming straight in. Also Harrison Marsh, Tim Membry, Matthew Dick, and Harry Cunningham is just one of the upgraded positions late in the draft.
From what I've seen of Tim Membry, a bit of a steal at 46, just too hard to go past that deep in the draft?
Yes, I do like him. I think he plays taller than 189. He plays like a Jack Darling, if you like, with his great marking up forward.
All right, well, speaking of Jack Darling, his club is the West Coast Eagles. They didn't enter the draft until round three. The first selection in round three, pick 45, was Brant College from Perth. If you ever look, their first couple of picks, Perth, South, Fremantle. So they've gone for a couple of locals first up.
And that's the challenge, isn't it, Shifter? You mentioned they have picked two locals to start because travelling away for some kids can be a challenge. They've kept their first two picks at home.
And I like College too. Again, shape, type, a kid that was a very talented player in a range of sports. He plays a tall forward.
He's a busy man, Ben Dixon. He's also tracked down West Coast coach John Worsfold.
John, the boys mentioned three selections that are staying in Perth and one outside. It must be great.
Yeah, it's excellent. Yeah, we're really pleased. You know, three WA boys, it's not something that we aim to do, but the way it fell, they all end up being homegrown talent and fill the needs we're looking for with young college who can play as a key position player, forward or back. And then young Adam Carter from South Fremantle, my old footy club, we're always happy to add another South Fremantle boy to the list, who's really good kick and can play as a small back and through the midfield. And Mark Hutchings, who was on the Saints rookie list a few years ago, and he's just really stuck at his footy and worked hard to earn himself another opportunity.
And coming into the draft, you had a fantastic year, and obviously great depth within your list. What was the main objective you wanted out of it?
Yeah, we were looking, these guys aren't, they're not urgent that they push up straight away. Our squad depth's pretty good, but for the future, we expect all of them to be really good players for us. So we're looking for a key position player. And then after that, we were pretty comfortable just to go with however the picks panned out for us.
Appreciate your time, John.
Thanks very much.
And last but certainly not least, the Western Bulldogs. It's been hard just grabbing hold of Brad Johnson tonight. He's had ants in the pants, hasn't been able to sit still in anticipation of those two top 10 picks, Jono.
And they've both been up here lineup? As well. So.
They have. We've had them up on stage as well tonight. And they handled themselves very well. But Jake String, he was the surprise pick. He wasn't touted to go in the top 10, but Bulldogs picked him at number 5.
Yeah, we've talked about the competitive edge, the one-on-one stuff. The one we haven't mentioned is Nathan Rovan, MVP for Vic Metro. He's Sammy Mitchell, if you like. He just keeps winning the ball at the stoppages, and it has worked so hard for his opportunity. He exits those stoppages right or left, hand and foot. I really like the way he goes about his work.
Tell us about Lockie Hunter, father-son pick. Yeah. What do we expect from him?
Well, a left-footer and a prolific goal kicker as well as ball winner. Had the old 33 and kick 6 in a game late in the year. Anyone seeing that game for the Western Jets said, hey, I've seen enough. He'll get drafted. And then, of course, the club had to bid. They bid in the third round and that allowed him to get to the Western Bulldogs.
All right, so that's how your team fared in this year's NAB AFL Draft. Well, pre-seasons are underway. The season will be upon us before we even know it. So much to look forward to. But right now, on behalf of Kevin Sheehan, Brad Johnson and Alistair Lynch, a big thank you to you gentlemen from us here at the Gold Coast Convention and Exhibition Centre. It's good night. We look forward to seeing you again soon right here on Fox Footy.
This has been a Fox Footy production.